Sweet hour of prayer, sweet. Everyone.
Good evening, my sister.
Welcome to the Proclamations of Hope Evangelistic Series and Social Intervention Program, Season 3. Whether you're joining us here under the tent or tuning in from the comfort of your homes, we are glad to have you joining us tonight. How could this program be a success without you? We sure do appreciate your presence, and we welcome you.
Indeed. Last night was our rest night, and I believe that you are well rested and couldn't wait to join with the preacher tonight. Tonight, he will look at the topic, Sister Fiona, under your nose. The evangelist has gone into the third gear, so you know that there is no slowing down or stopping him, but truth must be given as the naked truth, and tonight will be no less.
No less, my sister. So you know that the evangelist not only preaches, but he teaches, right? Yes. So the messages are plain, they're practical, and they are Bible-backed, and that is the most important thing. So don't get mad at the preacher for telling us the truth. Let's pray for him as he delivers the word of God each night. There's no doubt in my mind that these proclamations of hope are geared towards bringing hope to a hopeless generation.
Indeed. Definitely, my sister. Let all who has an ear to hear, let him hear.
Yes.
Get on board the proclamations of hope train. Tonight's proclamations number 13, under your nose, will be presented. So go ahead, share the link with your family and friends right now. Share the link on your statuses. Send it to your family and friends and invite them to watch on our YouTube page at Moneague Adventist Online and on Facebook. Our praise team is ready to set the tone for another worshipful experience. But before they come, why don't you join us in prayer? Kind, righteous, and heavenly Father, we give you thanks for yet another night where we can come and worship you and you alone, where we worship with our families and friends, whether they are here or online. In Jesus' name we say, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good evening, brethren. Good evening, brethren.
Good evening.
All right, as we continue our service for tonight, we are going to be doing some prayer songs, praise and worship, and I'm inviting you to sing along with us. The first song says, "Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you." Oh. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. Let's sing together. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
Open the eyes of my heart.
I want to see you.
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 To see you high and lifted up.
To see you high and lifted up.
Shining. Worthy to worship and adore. Searching for my way around in this world that's often frustrating.
Yeah.
Good night, everyone. Okay, let us get our attitude of prayer. Thank you, O Father. We thank you for your mercy and your goodness, O God. As we come in your presence this night, dear Father, we ask that you will help us, strengthen us, and uplift us, dear God. We thank you, Lord, for guiding us even throughout the day, O Lord, and even to this very hour as we come in your presence. We pray, Lord, that you will strengthen each and every one, Lord. We pray as we give you thanks, even for the rain that falls today, dear Father. We thank you. We thank you for your journey in mercy, and we thank you for all the blessings that you have restored upon us, dear Father God. We pray, Lord, that as we come to worship you, we pray that we'll give you a heart of worship. We pray, Lord, that as we listen, oh God, we pray that you will open our heart to your word, and that your word will take heed to your word, oh God. And even for those online, we pray, Father, that you will bless them, you will strengthen them, you will uplift them. Father God, we ask that as we continue to worship you, we pray that God, someone's heart, oh God, will open to your truth, and that someone will surrender in the mighty name of Jesus. Bless us even now as we look to you, in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Good evening, my brothers and my sisters, visitors. Good evening, everyone. All right, are you blessed? Feeling blessed? Are you happy to be alive? All right, that's wonderful, because many persons died today, and we're not in that stats. All right, so to the faithful and focused friendship, we say, we want to hear you say hallelujah. Faithful and focused friendship. All right. To the intentional. I'm not sure I'm seeing any of them here. All right. To the intentional and imperturbable Irons Mountain, I want to hear you say glory.
Glory.
All right, they're here. I'm just not seeing them. All right, the loyal and likable Lincoln, say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
The melodic and mindful Monique, say amen.
Amen.
Wonderful. The calm and caring Clover Hill, say glory, hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah.
Wonderful. Now to our virtual and valuable visitors in the house and online, I want you to type V and say victory in Jesus. Those in the house? We're not having any visitors in the house tonight? Yes. So I want to hear you say victory in Jesus. Amen. So we have a very big and large, notice I'm using those two words, growing online community. 1.4, 1.5. And so they're made up of a number of persons, the Canadians, those from USA, the Caribbean Islands, our own parishioners, those from Gryfield, Monique, Gibraltar, those from across the length and breadth of Jamaica, those in the satellite location in Urth and St. Catherine, I just want to say, even to our first timers and our regular visitors, whoever you are, welcome, 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 welcome everyone to the Proclamations of Hope series number 3. Time has flown by very quickly, and we are now in the third week of this riveting series. And God has been blessing us. What do you say? Yes, the Lord has been using his manservant or evangelist, Pastor Jermaine Johnson, to powerfully cry aloud, "Spare not." And he has been lifting up his voice like a trumpet. Men and women have seen their transgressions and have surrendered and are still surrendering their lives. There were some who walked in the watery grave of baptism. And so this gospel of the kingdom must be preached in all parts of our world for witness against the devil's camp. I urge you, therefore, to bring out our visitors, the bystanders, the curious, the puzzled, Uncle Barry, Sister Harry, Sister Sally, Cousin Susie. Tell them not to tarry, because we don't want to be sorry. Welcome, welcome. And as I pray that as you listen to the words of the Lord tonight, what's the topic again? And I'm a nose. I trust that your heart will truly be blessed, and that the word will come alive in your heart to be a powerful witness for the man Christ Jesus.
Amen. I love the thrill that I feel when I get together with God's wonderful people. I love the thrill that I feel when I get together with God's wonderful people. It's so nice to see those happy faces praising God in the heavenly places. I love the thrill that I feel when I get together with God's wonderful people. And I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. I just keep falling in love with him over and
on, put a smile on your faces while you sing
over and over again. It gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a joy between my Lord and I. He keeps loving and forgiving me over and over, over and over again.
Thank you very much, praise team. Good evening, everybody. And welcome. Turn to your neighbor and give them a big smile so that they feel added, that added welcome. Give them a hug if you have not seen them since yesterday. Come on, give them a hug. Praise the Lord. We're so happy to be out once more. What do you say? This morning we were really blessed with our prayer and fasting, and that ended with baptism. We were blessed yesterday with our social intervention program. Some 20 individuals benefited from the doctors in the house. Somebody say amen. Last week, over 50 persons benefited from the distribution of care packages, and several individuals benefited from the offerings of the Ministry of Labor and Social Security. And within days, you will hear about what we will be doing to close off our social intervention programs in this season. We thank God. The other night when I arrived, Monday night to be exact, Elder Kingsley, somebody called to me and said, "Pastor, we need you to pray a special word of prayer because the farmers are suffering. They are losing hundreds of thousands of dollars in crops that are being damaged by the sun, the lack of rain." And I said, "Well, I don't know if God wants an Elijah drought, but let us see what will happen." I was quite appalled today when I learned of the rains that fell here after we left prayer and fasting, Elder Carter. It was dry. Wasn't it dry when we left Elder Carter? When I saw the little dampings my side and I heard about what washout was out and what overflowed. But I know that God knew you needed it. And we're so happy that you got some rain. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Tonight, my brothers and sisters, very quickly, if you're a first time visitor, raise your hand. If you have invited persons in the chat, please put the name, put the number of persons you've invited out. If you're a visitor online, type V. You're a first time visitor, both of you, please come forward. I have gifts for you. And we're very happy tonight, brothers and sisters. And we can now tell you about all those who have made their pact with the Lord. As some sisters and brothers are joining, and let us continue to encourage persons to give their hearts to Jesus. Amen, somebody. So let me give the lady a book that matches her outfit, and then listen what you're gonna do. You know her? It's your wife, so you know her. Go home and read Genesis 4 verse 1. And when you're through reading, then you can share. Put your hands together for them, brothers and sisters. You know, I say, you know her? He said, my wife. He better know her. And tomorrow night, while we're at that, what's the subject? How to tie your man or woman. And no, I'm not coming with no aisle of this and aisle of that. So take your spouse tomorrow night. And the best dressed, the couple, that matches the best, we'll get a bottle of champagne to celebrate. Amen, somebody. Champagne for my campaign. So the couple that dresses the best, whether you're a married couple or you're engaged to get married. We know that you have to date before you get to that, but those are the ones that will qualify. Engage or married, and you come out here tomorrow night. Amen, brethren, because we're going to talk about the things tomorrow night. Do I have any first-time visitors to my right? No first-time visitors to my right. For those who are visiting online, I'm going to ask the tech folks to give them one of our digital books. Now, let me see the hands of those who invited our folks tonight for the tablet. I want to give away the tablet. How many do you bring? You brought two. All right, please take a note of that. Anybody else brought visitors tonight? All the other visitors came on their own accord. We are happy to have our visitors, whether they came alone by themselves, by general invitation, or by your direct invitation. Strawberry, we welcome you, and all those who are watching us, listening to us over there in Yorktown at the satellite location. Cordell Van Horn and Romaine Sievright, Tamara Green, and others, we are delighted to have you tonight. Brothers and sisters, as I go, I want us to bear in mind, tonight's subject is a very important one, as it deals with a subject, a topic that's often controversial, one that many people don't want to acknowledge. They prefer to just leave it as it is, but it's something that has to do with your spiritual destiny. Life or death surrounds it, and as a result of that, it is important for us to have clarity on the matter. As we look around us, we have many churches, we have many denominations, we have many ideas of worship, we have many days of worship. Tonight, we will be going into the Word of God as we get into a lecture, as we look from what the Bible has to say, not what man has to say, with the texts and the backings of history to show us what it is God desires of us. So reach out to all of your friends and your neighbors from all denominations, and let us go into the Word of God tonight and hear what the Bible has to say, lest you miss some things right under your nose. See you later on.
Good evening, Christian friends. We call on him when every storm clouds gather. We call on him to light our darkest day. Why must it be that when we're humbly lonely, fills to the brim, we call on him? Why don't we call on him before we lose our way, to count our blessing and thank him while we may? We call on Him when no one else will answer. We ask of Him a reason to go on. When our cups of joy becomes a cup of sorrow, filled to the brim, we call on Him. Why don't we call on Him before we lose our way? To count our blessings and thank Him while we
fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. It is that time again when we will be collecting the evening's offering. I must say it is a good thing to give to the cause of the Lord. As we give each time, we must give intelligently, know while we are giving. And we cannot lose when we give to the cause of the Lord. He sent the rain, He give us everything. And we also get a chance to partner with Him in giving to His cause and to help to garner people in the kingdom of heaven. The ushers, they are already in their place. And you look on your different devices online, You will see the different avenues that you can choose to give to the cause of the Lord. Invite you to bow your heads as I pray. Divine Heavenly Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus Christ for your goodness towards us as the children of Adam's fallen race. You would have sent Jesus Christ, the second Adam, for our restoration by shedding His blood, so we have the second chance. And so as we give to your cause, we pray that you may thus bless it, that it may go to the intended purpose that it will be collected for. Thank you, Lord, for those that have to give, and even those that don't have to give will give another time. We thank you, Lord, to Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen.
Our prayer time.
where we will lift up the name of the people to the Lord. And we have some requests with us. We'll just read a few. We need your Holy Spirit to save our souls, and that your will be done in our lives. And there is a list that they are seeking prayer for. Please pray for my daughter so she can come back to the fold. Also, my son, he is in, but he has no interest. My brother, who needs to return to the fold of safety before it is too late. I pray also for healing. Please pray for my nephew, who is suffering with kidney problems in and out of the hospital in USA. Please pray. Pray for my sister. She fell and tore the muscles in her legs. We won't call the names of the persons. We don't have to, because God is an all-knowing God. He knows the desires of our heart. He is touched with the feeling of our infirmities. There is no impossibilities with God, and tonight is no exception. Let's get into the attitude for prayer for those who can stand. Please do. As we approach your majesty reverently, as Elder Kelly will lead us in prayer.
You know, Sister Kelly, as we stand for prayer, a friend of mine sent something that family is praying for their 14-year-old daughter who went missing from March 12th. She have not returned home, and they are concerned where she could be. I can just imagine how that home is, missing their daughter. I tell you, Virgin, and there are so many things that is happening around us. And I'm going to ask you to do something for me, Virgin, as we pray. While I'm praying, just maybe, you know, someone who is going through a rough time. I'm going to ask you to put those persons to the Lord, that God will do something for them. And even our friends online, you know someone who is going through some challenging moments. Pray for them. God can set all men free.
Also, Elder, there are some requests that are typing in the chat as we speak. God has been recording your request.
Amen.
And all you need to do is to reach out by faith. He will answer.
Amen. Your heads are bowed. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege we have this evening to take everything to God in prayer. Mighty God, as I approach thy mercy seat, I ask that thou will wash me even now, O mighty God.
Yes, Lord.
That nothing will stand between you and me, and that this prayer will be answered on behalf of thy people.
Oh, yes, Lord.
Because, Lord, there is a mother who is crying out for the return of her daughter and her son. She's concerned, Lord, about their soul. And so, Father, I'm asking you right now in the name of Jesus, touch their hearts. I want to put those who are sick in your hands. Even the person who is challenged with a kidney problem. Great God, it was you who created, and it was you who placed those organs in the body. So we ask now in the name of Jesus,
yes,
touch those kidneys.
Touch.
Maybe there's someone here, Lord, who is challenged with a lungs problem, a heart condition, a liver problem. And even someone online might be saying, please pray for me especially. But Lord, I ask that thou will visit those in their homes.
Oh, yes, Lord.
Because you have the power to to do it for them. So Lord, we leave every sickness in your hand. Every disease, mighty God, it was you who have set all your people free. And we know that you can do it again.
Oh, yes.
Natisha Lee, who has went missing, Lord, I pray, Holy Father, that thou will comfort the hearts of the parents. Wherever she is, Lord, I pray that thou will bring her home safely. Because only you alone can set up the right rescue mission. Father, I'm asking you, please, dispatch angels that excel in great powers to encamp round about her even now. Because we know that you have the right team for this mission.
Oh, yes.
And Father, I'm asking you to save someone who is in the valley of decision. Someone who is struggling to make a decision for you, Lord, I pray that you will lift them up. There is someone who is in a relationship that is taxing them, Lord, and they don't know what to do. I'm asking you, Lord, to open the doors that they will see you high and lifted up.
Oh, yes.
There is a home that needs your presence. I ask, Lord, that you will bring peace in the home that there is no peace. And that you, Lord, that your presence will continue to abide. Father, please, your people are crying out for help. Come by here, sweet Jesus, and rescue your people today. I present the manservant to you, mighty God, Pastor Jermaine Johnson. I pray, Lord, that you will allow angels that excel in great powers to empower him.
Oh, yes.
And that you will use him mightily, O God, as he declared, thus saith the Lord. Allow him, Lord, to be used by the power of your Holy Spirit one more time. Fill this place with your presence. And Lord, when you shall burst the eastern skies, take each and every one of us home with you, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen.
Bless the Lord, everybody. Bless the Lord, everybody. Come on, give God some praise in the house. Give God some praise in the house. Give God some praise in the house at the name of Jesus. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Good evening, Moneague. Good evening to those who are online. It's a blessing to be alive. Yes, it's a blessing to be alive and to be alive at this time in earth history where we can be a part of the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we are happy that God has anointed his manservant, Pastor Jermaine Johnson, who has been preaching the word right here for the past 3 weeks. And tonight, I believe, is no exception. Your pastor is one of a kind. He's unique. There is none like him. He has a very unique and special way of bringing across the word of God. And nobody in his presence can say they don't understand the word. And so we are happy that God has blessed you at this time with Pastor Johnson, who he has used time and time again. And I believe that tonight he's going to give us another message. You have been praying for him. I invite you to continue to lift him up in prayer. Whatever is happening here does not just involve the preacher. All of us, all hands must be on deck for the winning of soul, because we believe that the coming king is at the door, and of course the trumpet need to be given a certain sound. Pray for the man of God. Support him night after night, even when you're feeling tired and don't feel like coming out. Be here in the night to support the man of God. But just before he comes, the praise team will give us the special as we wait for the man of God. May God bless you.
as you worship him tonight in the beauty of holiness.
I'm going to ask you to stand. I'm going to ask you to stand, everyone, everywhere.
Somebody Jesus, sing the name of Jesus.
Oh, Jesus.
Come on, shout Jesus, the name of Jesus.
Every day, your name is the same.
Somebody sing Jesus.
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus.
My Jesus.
How I love.
I love.
Calling your name.
To call in your name.
Oh, Jesus.
Sweet Jesus,
every day, come on now,
your name is the same.
Come on, somebody shout the name above every other name. Jesus. Come, somebody magnify the name of Jesus. God is good, and all the time. And hallelujah. Bow your heads with me. Everlasting Father, Lord God, in the name of Jesus we come. The one who has given us access to your throne of grace and mercy that we may come boldly. Thank you for the washing of water and the blood, and for regeneration and reconciliation, and for making us children through the merits of Jesus Christ and his righteousness.
by which we can come tonight and call you Father, and you won't turn us away saying we are jackets, because all who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Tonight, as we declare your everlasting words once again, as we preach and teach and baptize, I pray, O God, that you may anoint me with the sweet Holy Spirit. Give me clarity and fill me up, Lord, with the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, that the excellence of the glory may be of you and not of me. Take charge of every heart in the hearing of my voice, whether in the physical space or on the online, in the online environment, and help us to put away, God, all of those smoke screens, and put away all of those protective barriers we've put up to shield ourselves from the truth. And I pray tonight that somebody will know the truth, and the truth will set them free. We pray and say thanks in Jesus' name. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Good evening again, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen and friends. Thank you very much, praise team, for the song of meditation, beautifully sung as usual. And thank you, my friend and colleague, Pastor Heath, for coming tonight to hold up the preacher's hand. And he's coming all the way from down West Jamaica Conference. And we are very delighted that he has come to join us tonight. You know, he once served the district and still holds the district near and dear to his heart, even as we hold him near and dear to our hearts. So please bring greetings to the brethren down there in the Bull Savannah District of Churches. And we are also happy for his ministry. Recently was appointed the personal ministries director for the West Jamaica Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. Digital Disciples for Christ, go ahead and give the thumbs up and share the link if you have not yet done so, to help somebody get this all important message. As we delve into tonight's word, remember tomorrow night's topic, how to tie your man or woman. Come out with your special person. Come with your boyfriend, girls. Come with your girlfriend, boy. Come with your man, woman. Come with your woman, man. Come with your spouse. Come with your fiance, your fiancee. And remember that the couple that dresses the best, matches the best, will receive the champagne for the campaign. Somebody say amen. And then on Sabbath, we'll look at the subject, his name shall be called Jesus. But for tonight, proclamation number 13, under your nose. Under your nose. Our key text, blessed are they who hear the word of God and do what? Obey it. Luke 11 verse 28. John 10, 27, 28 tells us that what? My sheep. Who sheep? God's sheep. Hear my voice, says Jesus. And I know them, and they do what? They follow me, and I give them what? Eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand, sister long. When Jesus takes a hold of you, only you can come out if you want to come out. And Acts 5 and verse 32. And we are his witnesses to these things. And so also is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to whom? To those who obey him. The axiom under your nose, sometimes personalized in the first person, under my nose. If you're a Jamaican, you must know the term under my nose, because you used to watch it. Am I talking to you? When you talk about under your nose, it typically refers to something that is right in front of you or very close to you, yet you fail to notice or recognize it. Give me a little more juice on the monitor. It's a figurative expression, Nelda Morrison, often used to highlight how people can conveniently overlook the obvious or fail to see what is right in front of them due to distraction, preoccupation, or a lack of attention. Yeah. Sometimes people fail to notice what's under their nose because they are not paying attention. But sometimes people willfully choose to ignore what's under their noses. You see, we sometimes live our lives delusionally with a false belief or judgment about reality, held despite incontrovertible evidence to the contrary, occurring especially in mental conditions. So there are those who will tell you that I can see the evidence for myself, but I am not changing my position. So sometimes people are willfully delusional, choosing to act a certain way despite evidence indicating that they should act another way. Am I talking to somebody tonight? So as a result of that, there are folks who are confronted with the truth but still prefer to walk in a lie because they have been walking in it for too long. There are many who take pride in what they do. Well, you ought to take pride in what you do. And can you imagine, after holding a certain stance for so many years, only to find out that you were wrong? It takes a special kind of guts for you to man up and woman up to the truth, because the truth shall set you free. Every time Jesus preached the word, notwithstanding his difference approach to messiahship than what the Jews expected, he said to them, I know that I do not match your expectations, but for the very work's sake, accept that I am the Son of God. But notwithstanding the works, they still rejected Jesus, even though the incontrovertible evidence was right under them nose. So there are persons who miss out on things, Elder Kelly, because they really don't know. It is ignorance at its best. But there are those who see the truth and they care not to change position despite it being under your nose. That's why we have so many wolves in sheep clothing, because some recognize that they need to change, but because of status and position and connection and network, they have said to themselves, God, I know that this is not what you wanted for me, but you must can understand a long time it and so, and nobody can change me. But brothers and sisters, when the truth has come to men, the Bible says at the time of our ignorance, God winks. Come somebody, blink your hand to your face one side. I said, go on. But now, somebody say, but now, he commands all men everywhere to repent. When you don't know, God is willing to overlook it. But when you have come into contact with the truth, God expects a change in your life. Somebody say, a change must come. As we talked about the kingdoms that Daniel foresaw in vision in Daniel chapter 2, we talked about Babylon, the head of gold. Do you remember the next one? The Medes and the Persian. We talked about Greece. We talked about Rome. Speaking of the fourth kingdom, and we've been addressing it for some time, Daniel points out in Daniel 7 verse 25 that the leader of that kingdom at some stage shall speak pompous words against the Most High and shall persecute the saints of the Most High, like I showed you on Monday night, and shall intend to change times and laws. Yes, the book of Daniel has been so pinpointedly accurate about the future that it had predicted, that some skeptics claim that the book was written after the facts. But when they look at the history, the incontrovertible evidence pointed out that Daniel was written before all of that took place, because my God knows the past, the present, and the future. He doesn't guess. Everything is open to him. So Daniel, long before the Roman kingdom, which became the Roman Catholic Church, came on the scene, said that one day you're going to have a false religious system who shall persecute the saints because the saints don't want to follow their errors and fallacies and lies and deception. And they are also going to think to change what? Times and what? Laws. Come on, remember those two things. What two things, everybody? Times and laws. When you talk about time, you're talking about weekdays. You're talking about calendar days. You're talking about months and years and hours. And when you talk about laws in the biblical context, you are talking about God's commandments. Somebody talk to somebody. Thousands of years Before Adventism came about, before Pentecostalism came about, before baptism came about, thousands of years, God said one day there is going to be a system that shall seek to change time and law. But what could give any church or system the audacity, tenacity, dexterity, authority to change God's time and law? Well, in the book of Matthew chapter 16, jump over there. When Jesus was with his disciples, he had asked them, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they began to name the different persons they claim him to be. Then Peter said to Jesus, listen, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And what did Jesus say in verse 17? Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto you, but my what? My Father who is in heaven. And if you think that you can play on words and I can play on words, Jesus said, I say unto you, you are Peter. Because Peter comes from the Greek word Petros, which means a rolling stone, just a little stone, like where you could have used shoot arm but with slingshot. But upon this rock, because notice that Jesus is God. When they saw the way he taught, they asked, where did he get his authority? When Nicodemus, an erudite ruler of the Jews, saw the astuteness of his teachings, he said that you are a what? A great teacher come from God. For no man can do the things you do except God is with him. So Jesus knows the difference between this and that. Jesus knows how to use the demonstrative pronouns. So Jesus said that, listen, you are Peter. Because when Jesus, what did he say? Blessed are thou, Simon, son of Jonas, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto you, but my Father's in heaven. You know, so Peter get boozy. So Peter started to smile and said, oh Lord. And the other disciples got jealous. But just as he was getting boozy and full of himself, Jesus said, hey, don't get too cocky. You never got the revelation because you graduated from NCU. You never got it because you have a PhD or an MA or a BSc. Flesh and blood did not reveal it unto you. But whom? My Father who? My Father who is in heaven. And I say unto you, before you get too strong in yourself, that you are Peter, but upon this, come on, church of God. You know you are going, man. So the system that was prophesied to attempt to change time and law, that system claims that Peter was the first pope. And they said that this was Jesus saying to Peter that the church is going to be built upon a man. But jump over there to Ephesians chapter 2, 20 to 21. It's a lecture tonight. Are you ready? Ephesians 2, 20 to 21 says, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the what? The chief cornerstone. The church is not built upon a man. The church is built upon Christ, the solid rock. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. In whom the whole building, being fitted together, grows into a holy temple to the Lord. So notice the part that they misconstrued. In verse 19 of Matthew 16, Jesus says to Peter, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. So what they were saying, God turned over ultimate authority to Peter. I said, Peter, when you're lucky, it's still locked. And when you open it, it's still open. But shortly after that, the same Peter that Jesus was simply saying, when you are converted and have become one with God, one not in that you are a God yourself, but your will now gives in or submits to the will of God, you will know what to bind and you will know what to lose. When you are in oneness with God, you have divine clarity. So whatever you do will be keeping with the Spirit of God. Can I put it where you can touch it? Somebody say touch it. When Adam Adam was in his perfect state. I talked to you about it that in the first night or so. The Bible says God gave him the task to name the animals. And everything that Adam named the animals, that was the name thereof. It's not like God was saying, you know, Adam, if you want to call that one a lion, it is a lion. No, God was like, whoa, what a way the boy bright. It is a lion indeed. Why? Because before sin, there was no dissonance. There was no breakage between the connection of God and man. So as a result of that, we had clarity. That's why the Bible says, how shall a young man clear his way? How will you have a clear future? How will you know how to order your steps and to have a successful life? By taking heed according to the word of the Lord. So because Peter was going to be converted by and by, Jesus never said, I give you, I will give you the key. Because when you are a child of God, the Spirit of God will direct you in the will of God. So anything you bind are because God didn't tell you if you bind. And anything you lose is because God tell you to lose. It's how you listen to the preacher tonight. But shortly after that, the Bible says, Jesus told them about his mission to be betrayed of evil men and killed and raised on the third day. And then Peter was like, that will never happen. You will never live to see it happen. And listen to what Jesus said to the same Peter a few verses later on. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord. This shall not happen to you. But he, Jesus, turned and said to Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. For you are an offense to me. For you are not mindful of the things of God, but of the things of what, church? Men. At that time, the church built upon, Peter is a rolling stone, just a Petrus. But Jesus is the solid rock. He is the Petra. So watch this. So this Jesus has never flinched with words when it came on to the foundation of the lifestyle of the saved. That's why he says to the same disciples and all of Christians today in John 14:15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Notice Jesus never said, you may keep my commandments. It was not optional. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. In other words, it no matter where you want to say, if you not keep them, you not love Jesus. Raise hand if you love Jesus tonight. If you don't love him, then raise it, because it will drop off. Come lift your time and take it from underneath your armpit and swing it. G, take it down. If you love me, keep my commandments. Can you imagine Jesus telling you that the litmus test that proves that you love him, and then take the commandments, they're gonna nail up a Calvary right after that? Hello? Can you imagine Jesus telling you, Sister Mackenzie, that, hey, this is how people show me that they love me. Some woman say, if you love me, you have to buy me nice clothes. Some man say, if you love me, you have to have sex every night. So woman say, if you love me, you have to do this, you have to do that. Jesus said, let me tell you how you sure say you love me. Keep my commandments. So if Jesus took the commandments after that, and boom, boom, a whole y'all gonna love him. Which was a word? Action, not a bag of mouth. Come on, somebody. So what's the word now? Genesis 2, verses 1 to 3, points out a commandment that many have been willfully violating right under your nose. And because we have gotten so accustomed to it, we don't see it again. Can I break it down in plain terms? Everybody get used to their own body odor. So when you want beard, you're not so repulsed by yourself, but as somebody else will want beard, carry on your smelling. Sometimes we get so used to the things we do that we are no longer repulsed of them. But blessed are they that smell themselves and go well afresh. Come on now. Genesis 2, 1 to 3. Come on, read, church. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them were finished. And on the what? The seventh day. This is the first book of the Bible introducing a day. What was that system going to attempt to do according to Daniel's prophecy, Brother Bury? It's nice to call you Brother Bury. Times and law. So the seventh day is a time-related command. Come on now, church. And because it's a command, it is a law. The seventh day, God work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he has done. Do you know anybody who rests on the seventh day? Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it. Something that is sanctified is set apart for holy purpose, because in it he rested from all his work which God created and made. And God never rest, Sister Sandia, because he was tired. He rested to set us an example, and when God set it, nobody reset it. So that is why, after hundreds of years in Egyptian bondage, Israel had lost sight of the truth of God, of the truth of their origin, of the truth of their purpose, of the truth of their identity, and of the truth of his commandments. So God had to teach them it all over again. So when he gave Moses the commandments, all commandments were like, thou shalt not. Thou shalt not. Listen, I am the Lord your God, brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. No time. Thou shalt have what? Not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything. No time. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. No time. Honor your mother, your father, that your days may be long. Well, at least you get length of time and that. Thou shalt not kill. And if you believe that was new, remember that God judged, came for killing Abel. Are we together, brothers and sisters? Thou shalt not steal, etc. But hear the fourth one. Remember. You can't tell somebody if you remember something if you never tell them before. Come on, church of God. What a day when you're leaving out to go school, child. I am gonna call you and say, John, yes, mommy, remember to buy the thing when you're coming from school. I am gonna never tell you if you buy nothing. You're going to, hey, mommy, a John, you know? A John. Because you can't say remember if you never told the person before. Am I talking the truth? So watch me now, brothers and sisters. It's a lecture tonight. The Bible says, God said, remember. And by the way, when God created the seventh day, in the text I just read, Genesis 2:1-3, where was Abraham? Hundreds of years from being born. Where were the Jews then? If Abraham is the father of the Jews, Abraham never born yet. Come on, somebody. Do you know how old Adam was when he died? 930, and Abraham never born yet. You're not hearing the preacher in here tonight. Methuselah died at 969, and Abraham never born yet. Hello, somebody. Abraham never come till after flood. Are you sitting to preach now? Brothers and sisters, not let nobody fool you. The seventh-day Sabbath was created from creation. If it is clear, raise your hand. Come on. You have to practice filling up your hand for truth, because sometimes everything we under your nose when I write here, God, you have to blow it out tonight. Blow it out like booger. So God said, remember the Sabbath day to do what, everybody? Keep it holy. Why is it holy? Because God sanctified it. He blessed it. 6 days shall thou labor and do what? All your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. So an Adventist own it. When people want dash away, they say Adventist worship on Saturday, but this a female day. And you are right, it's your day, because God's day is the seventh day. Any day that is not the seventh day, I feel. Because God says 6 days, man must do theme work. So anything will happen upon day one, a man's work. Anything will happen upon day 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, a man's work. But what happens on the seventh day must be God's work. Come on, somebody. 6 days, the Lord what? Made the heaven and the earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested on the Sabbath day. And therefore he did what? The Lord sanctified it. He blessed it. He hallowed it. He set it apart. And he says, you must remember it. And he says, listen, when you remember it, nobody must work in it. Your son, your daughter, your manservant, your maidservant, and hear this part now in the look, are you a stranger within your gate? When you obey this commandment, anybody will come here yard weekend must carry church clothes. Because you're not come to church unless they're sick. I And if they're sick, and sick like that, maybe I go stay away from church and nurse them. And wonder, I watch wrestling, I watch Netflix, Palaf in the L-Sex channel, I watch YouTube video and Kinty prank, and you there church a holy, holy, a hoof a yard. God say he loved Abraham because he knew that Abraham would do what? Command his household after him. When you are a true Seventh-day Adventist, when you are a true Sabbath keeper, you don't make nobody run your yard, or you run the yard. And anybody will see them coming for the weekend, family, friend, or foe, let them know, say, a church we are going to go. Yes. Come on, somebody. Yes. You can't, their church and people are run shop. You can't do a church and somebody drive the taxi. Your manservant or your maid servant. You can't do a church and man dig I'm ground for you. Everybody must have keep Sabbath. Come on, Church of God. So watch me now. Is the seventh day an individual thing where each gets to choose which day is their Sabbath? Or is it a set day of each week? One of the most striking examples to prove this point is found in Exodus 16. When God fed the Israelites with manna. Anybody remember the bread? God commanded them that they must take up how much portion, how many portions per day? One. And they must not leave anything till the morning. Read all of Exodus 16 when you get the time. In the interest of time, I won't go through. God commanded them that they must go out each day and take one serving per meal or enough. Just eat till your belly full. But don't left no Sunday, Monday. No left no Monday, Tuesday. But some of the people never believed God. So you know what they did? They left some till the morning. And it stank and bred worms. And God cursed the people for it. I said, how long will you disobey my laws, my commandments, and fail to walk in my precepts? But when the sixth day came, somebody said here, number six. Verse 5 says, and it shall be on the sixth day that they shall prepare what they bring him, and it shall be twice as much as they gather daily. So God is not going to turn around this time. No, because your provision is sustained by obedience to the Lord. Yes. If you want your provision to maintain and to be sustained, you have to obey the Lord. Are we together? So hear what the Bible says further on. The Bible says in verse 22, it was that they gathered twice as much, two omers for each. All that the rulers of the congregation came to Moses and told him. And the Bible said, this is what the Lord said. Tomorrow is a Sabbath rest, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. Bake what you will bake today. Boil what you will boil. Lay up for yourself all that remains to be kept till the morning. What is that? Preparation. The sixth day was known as the preparation day. That's why when Jesus died, as we will see shortly, that day was known as the what? Preparation day. Tell me what the systems nowadays refer to it as. What? Holy Good Friday. Hello, somebody? The Bible has a different name for it. Preparation day. And why don't call it Good Friday? Because if you call it preparation day, your pitney might go ask you, what you are prepared for? Hello, somebody? If you call it the Bible's name, which is the preparation day, Sister Carter, your sensible G Sata Pepper, rather, and C Secker might say, what are we preparing for? And some don't want to answer that question because they rather to ignore the truth under their nose. So brothers and sisters, you must boil where you are boiled today. That's why they put the bus be from Friday Adventist. That's why they close the bus press from Friday. And by the way, you can't press the close from Wednesday and from Sunday. You know what? The easier things become is the more worthless some of us have become. When people have to use them cool iron, and have to sit down and wait until cool iron hot up, the iron close by Thursday. Now you have steam iron, and you can't iron till Sabbath morning. When people have to use coal stove, someone don't go like on a stove, and they never burn a bush. Say amen. Coal stove and wood fire. The fish don't fry. Stew don't stew. Rice and peas don't cook with some ginger for lace it and healthy preserve it. And everything ready for Saturday. Now we have electric stoves and gas stove, and you can't cook till Saturday morning. When people have to walk for miles from Lincoln to Moneague, if you go crusade, and I walk with them tilly lamp People now miss Tuesday at the night time. And then now come to church late. Now we have car and bus and taxi. And you dry your foot and come in the church at 11 o'clock. We say amen for the amen. Amen. If our foreparents had these luxuries, God would have to translate them. Because with all the difficulties of Sabbath preparation, they were faithful. And some of us are abusing the luxuries that God has blessed us with. Am I talking truth? So you must bake where you are bake on the Friday, God said. Boil where you are boil. Roast where you are roast. And put it down till the morning. That's why they come up with Sunday, Monday. And a Sunday, Monday night, a Friday, Saturday. Because tomorrow. So the point I'm making, read the rest of Exodus 16 in your own timing. If the seventh day was an individual day, then with all the hundreds of thousands of people, Sister Lam, Moses would have to keep a documentation of who for day starts Sunday, week starts Sunday, which week starts Monday. I say, hey, John, oh, your week starts Monday. Oh, so your seventh day is Sunday. So you're not supposed to go out on Sunday. Oh, Paul, you're seven. You started Tuesday now, so your week starts on Tuesday. So your 7 days Monday. Brethren, a papa show business that. It was a set day of each week. Somebody say set it. So the question now, what is the Sabbath's relationship to the other commandments? Go to James chapter 2, 10 through 11. Everybody read aloud. For whoever shall keep the whole law. Wait there. I tell you it's the lecture night. Sister Hillary. James the apostle. When did he write his epistle? After the death of Jesus or before? After. I want everybody to answer. After the death of Jesus or before? After. All of these came after the death, resurrection, and what? Ascension of Jesus. Turn to your neighbor and say, Easter Sunday gone. And I'm using Easter Sunday as per their labeling. Not per my affirmation. Are we together, brothers and sisters? So how James, an apostle of the Lord, years after Jesus gone back to heaven, if Jesus had nailed the laws to the cross, come on people, nobody know the cross is tonight. If Jesus had nailed the laws to the cross, how comes this apostle, listen, Elder Luke, I hear me about Jesus through the Bible. But James, like John said, they handled him. They touched him. They saw him face to face. They ate with him. They drank with him. So if anybody know Jesus, it's James.
That's right. Yes, sir.
Come on, somebody. The truth of the matter, I am preaching plain Bible truths tonight. And anybody know our seat, I see them know our seat, because they're right under their nose. James says, whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in what? One point. He is guilty of some. He is guilty of a portion. He is guilty of the one that he is guilty of. He is guilty of what? All. And just when you are tempted to say, God is such a loving God, and I know that my God is not as strict as these church people, God knows that this is how I grew up going to church, and he knows that I love him because every Sunday I'm there, every Wednesday, whichever day your church worship on, but it's not a Saturday. If you think breaking one commandment is a simple thing, ask Adam and Eve how many they broke. Hello, people of God. If you believe breaking one of God's commandments is a simple thing, ask Adam and Eve how many they broke. Am I talking to church tonight? If you broke one, you're guilty of all 10. For he who said, do not commit adultery, said, do not murder. Now, if you do not commit adultery but a murder, have you become a transgressor of the law? Yes. So let's go back to Exodus now. Very crucial matter. Exodus 31, 12 through 17 makes it clear. And the Lord spoke to Moses. Who spoke, everybody? Moses spoke, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak also to the children of Israel, saying, read this aloud. Surely my Sabbaths you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord who what sanctifies you. What did Jesus say in John 17, verse 17? Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. So when you obey the commandments of God to include the Sabbath, it's a sign of your sanctification.
Set apart,
set apart. That's why Isaiah 40 verse 8 tells us, Sister Gordon, the grass with us, say the grass burn down. And the flowers fall, say the flowers dry. But the word of God shall stand forever. That's why Isaiah 8 and verse 20 declares, to the law and to the testimony. No move so fast, Sister Johnson. No move so fast. To the what? The law and to the testimony. When we looked at the subject, snake and the grass, before snake and the grass, what did we look at again Sunday night? What was the subject again Sunday night? Baby, the ultimate baby mother drama. The dragon, who is whom again? Satan, was angry with the woman, which represents what again? The church of God. And what did the Bible use to describe the woman? The remnant of her seed, which do two things. Keep the what? Commandments of God. Give me another name for commandments. Laws. And of the what? Testimony of Jesus. Come on, Lord have mercy. Come on now, church. So Isaiah said long before that, to the law, by the way, Revelation is the last book of the Bible, you know. And the same thing that Isaiah said centuries before, I eat Johnson in Revelation 12 about the church of God. Yeah. To the law and to the testimony. See the remnant church, you know, the Old Testament church. If they do not speak according to this word, it is because there's no light in them. Anybody who stands and tells you that you don't have to keep the testimony of Jesus and the laws of God are darkness. He could have full of suits like Superman, a darkness. In no matter how fiery he preach, a darkness. In no matter how long she know the truth, darkness. Anybody who tells you otherwise than what the Bible says is darkness. Somebody say darkness. Hear what the New Living Translation says. Look to God's instructions and teachings. People who contradict his word are completely in the dark. So listen to the counsel of Isaiah 58, 13 and 14. If you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, somebody say take your foot off of it. From doing your pleasure on my holy day. And when you put your foot on something, it means say, yeah, do what? Give me one word. You're trampling it. Stamp it out. Every day, God tell me about this. I can't do it. You know, say, Sabbath are the best business day. Stamp it out. Yeah, we can't go to church on it. Sabbath are the best day if you got watchers. You know, see, you don't get pack up. Stamp it out. You can't get no work if you don't work on Saturday nowadays. Because as soon as I tell them, say, you're an Adventist, then tell them, say, they cannot assist you with that. You have to show up. Stamp it out. Stamp it out. Yes. Hello, somebody. If you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy day of the Lord, honorable and shall honor him, not doing your own ways. So you can't walk up and down around the church and chat about what you're doing at the week. Not finding your own pleasure. You can't pull off in a church by phone and browse Facebook and a chat when church are going on the sermon and preach. Not speak in your own words. You can't chat, but you can't chat about your own lifestyle. Come on, someone. Then you shall delight yourself in the Lord, and I will cause you to do what, church? Ride upon the high hills of the earth and feed you with the heritage of Jacob your father. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. And when God talk, no dog bark. If you want a blessing, don't just come to church on Saturday the seventh day, but keep it according to what I just read. Amen. Cause some come to church, but they're not keeping the Sabbath. Then they're all over the place. When I preach in time, you're out of door for laugh and chat. When I time for the sermon, all of a sudden you have one bag of meat for them. When I time for you for worship, all of a sudden you have something you attend to. At church you come. Somebody will love the distraction. Everybody wants to have conversation when at church time. When that time for worship, you have to say, hey, lock it off. But there are some other things that people hear. Those who have been ignoring God's Sabbath, though it is under their nose, then come up with some fancy teachings and theories from scriptures to say that they are proving that you don't have to keep the Sabbath anymore. And here's one of the big ones. Colossians 2:13. Come over there. Colossians Colossians 2:13 tells us going down, and you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. That sound good, not sure that. A grace that at work. Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements. Tell me, what did he write out, everybody? The handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. See where they get it from? So they claim that the Ten Commandments were the unwriting of requirements and that Jesus nailed them to the cross. But this is what he said. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he, Jesus, made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it, so that let no one judge you in what? Food or in drink or regarding a what? A festival, a new moon, or Sabbath. Notice that the Sabbath comes with a common S, and the Sabbath, which are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. Now, let us look at what the handwriting of requirements were, sometimes referred to as the ordinances. Let us look at what was against us to see what was nailed to the cross. Are you ready? 2 Chronicles 33 verse 8. Come on, students. And I will not again remove the foot of Israel from the land which I have appointed for your fathers, only if they are careful to do that what? All that I have commanded them, according to the what? Whole law and the statutes and the ordinances by the hand of Moses. So when you talk about the handwriting of requirements, you're referring to what sometimes is called the laws of Moses. But you don't mean the laws of Moses as in to say Moses made them up. But God told Moses what to write and to say, Moses, this is what you shall say to the people. Come on now. So when you talk about the handwriting, what you're talking about? Laws of Moses. So look at Deuteronomy 31, 24 through 36. So it was when Moses had completed writing the words of this law in a book. Come on now. Where did Moses write the words of the law? Everybody must remember that. Come back. Where did Moses write the words of the law? In a book. When they were finished, that Moses commanded whom? The Levites who bore the Ark of the Covenant, saying, take this book, somebody said take it, of the law, and put it where? Beside the Ark of the Covenant. Come on, of the Lord your God, and it shall be there as a witness where? You're not really loud enough, man. It shall be there as a witness where? Against you. What did Colossians say? He blotted out the handwritings of requirements that were what? Against you. According to this text, which writing was against the people? That which Moses wrote with his hand where? In a book, and placed it where? Beside the Ark of the Covenant. And it shall be a witness where? Against you. Come on, church. That is what the Bible says. Jesus blotted out. But we go further. Somebody should go further. Come on, shake it off, everybody. Come on. Adventists, I forgot to learn it tonight. Because you forgot to preach it after me done preach them. Deuteronomy 4, 13 and 14. Come on online, people. Sister Marcy. Hear me now, Dr. Lynch. And hear me now, Sister Chelsea over there in the UK. So he declared, Deuteronomy 4, 13 and 14, to you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, the Ten Commandments, and he, God, wrote them on two tablets of stone. But see, somebody said, but see, where did Moses write his ceremonial laws? In a book, and placed it where, Sister Clark? Beside the Ark of the Covenant. Come on now, church. But where did God write the Ten Commandments? Two tablets of stone. And can some bright student tell me another title for those two tablets? Of the testimony. And the Lord commanded me at that time to teach you statutes and judgments, that you might observe them in the land which you cross over to possess. Nothing says the Ten Commandments was against them. Not at all. But it gets better. That's why Exodus 31 verse 18 declares, and when he, God, Sister Lo, had made an end of speaking with him, Moses, on Mount Sinai, he gave Moses two tablets of the what? Shout it loud, the bread man. Two tablets of the word, Brother Lawrence. Testimony. What did we just read in Isaiah 8, verse 20? To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, there is no what? Light in them. How did we know about God's pure, pretty woman in Revelation chapter 12? The remnant, the dragon went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the water, the commandments of God, and of the what? The testimony of Jesus. Bible can't clear than that. Can Bible be clearer than that, brethren? Come on, somebody, ain't not done yet. Say, not done yet. So, I'm going to read it again. When God was through speaking with Moses on Mount Sinai, he gave Moses two tablets of the testimony. Tablets of stone written with the what? You know you are going there, sir. What did he write there with everybody? What did Moses use to write his? Handwriting. And what did Moses write his in? A book. Where did Moses place it? He gave it to the Levites to place where? Beside the Ark of the Covenant. But who wrote the Ten Commandments? God. Which pen did he use? The ballpoint of his finger. What did he write it on? Two tablets of stones, aka two tablets of what? Testimony. And even when Moses came down and saw the people's idolatry and dropped the tablets, I threw them to the ground and they broke, God said, tell you what, cut out two stones, carry up ya. Because God is not God, that a fool. God knew said this time was gonna happen. God knew that there was gonna be a time when men would claim that his commandments are no longer relevant. So God said, Moses, because every constitution, every government has to be built upon solid laws. Me nah make you righty. Cause them go say a few. So God said, look here, where you break them for? Carry two tablets come. Me I go write them back with me what? One finger, tablets of stone written. So watch me, I ain't done yet. So he was there with the Lord, Moses with the Lord in this Mount Sinai, 40 days and 40 nights. He neither ate bread nor drink water. And he wrote on the tablets of the words, I mean, that's he, God, notice the capital E, H, wrote on the tablets the words of the what? Covenant. So the Ten Commandments were referred to as the what? Covenant. The covenant relationship determines the stipulations, the expectations of God and the obligations of his people to him. Everything that God does is done within a covenant. The Adamic covenant said, Adam, don't eat, and the day you eat, you shall die. Adam, yam, that's why we're dead. God has always treated with his people with him the ambits of a covenant. And you're going to see the covenant never nailed to the cross. God just changed it up. And you know, really change it up as in saying that's where the old. He actually shows the fullness of it. Hear this now. And he wrote on the tablets the words of this covenant, the Ten Commandments. You know, you're not yet. Hear Deuteronomy 5:22 now, Pastor Heath. These words the Lord spoke to all your assembly in the mountain from the midst of the fire, the cloud, and the thick darkness with a loud voice, and he added no more, and he wrote them on what, everybody? Two tablets of stone, and gave them to me. So may I ask Moses one question? Well, I'm going to pretend to be Moses, and you are going to be the ones to ask me the question. Where do we them? Now you're going to ask me, Moses, now, what did you do with them, Moses? I can't hear you. What did you do with them, Moses? So let me read the verse again, then you ask me that. Then I turned and came down. Oh, come back. Whatever did for that. Deuteronomy 5:22. These words the Lord spoke to all your assembly in the mountain from the midst of the fire, the cloud, and the thick darkness with a loud voice, and he added no more. You hear that, Virgin? No, we're not going to finish the text yet. He added no more. So what God was saying, hey, me finish talking, not add, not take away from it. And he, God, wrote them, Brother Fullerton, on two tablets of stone and gave them to me. Let me tell you what I did with them children. Deuteronomy 10, verse 5. Then I turned and came down from the mountain. So come down, Moses. And put the tablets in the ark, which I had made. And there they are. are just as the Lord commanded me. But hold on there, somebody. Hold on there. What did Moses use to write his ceremonial laws? His handwriting. Where did Moses write them? In a book. Not this book. And then he placed them where? Beside the Ark of the Covenant. But who wrote the Ten Commandments? God. What did he use to write them? His own finger. And what did he write them on? Two tablets of stone. And whom did he give them to? Moses. To place where? In. Lord have mercy. Come on, church. So watch me now. Moses' writings in a book went beside the ark. But God's writing on the stone. And two tablets inside of the ark. Come on now, people. You cannot get any clearer than this. Hello, let us look at what happened. The Ark of the Covenant, next slide, was in the most holy place. And the Ark of the Covenant had the mercy seat atop of it with the covering cherubs. And the presence of God was represented by the Shekinah glory. It lit up the entire place at this dedication of Solomon's temple. And it was to indicate to the children of Israel that God is in their midst. But because of their sinful nature, God was enshrouded in that most holy place that only the high priest could access once per year on the Day of Atonement, which was the Day of Judgment. And if you are God, quote, go judge people, Lord, if he did it.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yes, sir. What a thing.
So because the laws of Moses, as in the ceremonial laws, were but a shadow, Colossians, of things to come. Those laws tell you that if you sin a certain sin, you bring goat, you bring sheep, or you bring what? Oxen, or you bring turtle dove, or you bring crane, or you bring pigeon, or you bring isle, or you bring this, depending on your circumstances. Are we together, brothers and sisters? All of those were pointing to whom? Jesus. It also told them how to maintain the sanctuary. In Exodus 25 verse 8, God said, let them make me a what? A sanctuary that I may do what? Dwell among them. In other words, me can't come into the open like what I did with Adam and Eve before sin, because my holy presence will destroy sinful men. So I have to protect them from myself. But a time is going to come when the shadow shall meet the reality of Jesus Christ. That's why when Jesus died on Calvary, the Bible said that what? The veil that separated the most holy place was torn from what? Top to bottom. Jesus said, access my children. Yeah. And listen what was inside. Beside the Ark of the Covenant, you had the book of the law. And then tell me what else you had inside now. You had what? The golden pot of manna to remind Israel how God supplied for them over the years. You had Aaron's rod that budded. And you also had the what? The two tablets of the testimony. What was God saying? I sit on the foundation of my laws. Yes. Come on, church of God. I sit on the foundation of my laws. So when you come to my court, I'm going to judge you based on what I sit on. Come on, somebody. When judge go to court, judge don't you deal with opinions. Judge have to work with the law. And if I don't work with the law, then we dash over the case. So God's judgments are built upon the commandments. Come on, somebody. Yes. Notice what Moses wrote in a book, because it was not meant to be everlasting. But what did God write on? Two tablets of stone. And not that you want dash way.
No.
Come on, church of God. That's why Romans 7 verse 12 declares, Sister CJ, therefore the law is holy. Hold on there, hold on there. Somebody say, come back here. Come, push up your shoulder them again. Roll them over. Shake it off. Who wrote the book of Romans? The Apostle Paul. You know who they use the most to go against the law? The same Paul. Who wrote Colossians? The same one, Sister Bury. That then claims, say, you hear that? He blotted out the handwriting of ordinances that were against us. The Bible says that the book of the law was written to be a witness against them. Not the Ten Commandments. That's why God placed them where? Inside of the Ark of the Covenant. So here they see in Paul. Therefore, the law is holy. So it is holy, but Jesus dash away. And the commandment holy and just and what? Good. Is a good God going to throw something just? Only workless Jamaicans dash out things were good. Some Jamaicans don't have no standards of righteousness, you know. They choose according to friend and company. I saw where somebody shared a post this afternoon. Let me see. He said, people don't defend what is right anymore. They defend who they like. You hear that, people? People don't defend what is right anymore. They defend what? Who they like. So if a criminal is taking care of somebody, look here, you don't think a saint did it. That's why some of you have the scammers in your yard. But because scammer make your name act steal, nobody can talk to your scammer. Because scammer make you drive in a Mark X, nobody can talk to your scammer. But one day, God is going to chop your line. Are you listening to me, Grandfield? Are you listening to me, Crossroad? The law is holy. And just in case somebody going to say, Paul, what do you mean when they say law? Because you know, so we're not dealing with the Ten Commandments anymore. Paul said the same one. The commandment is holy. And just and good. And anybody read something like this and still tell you that you don't have to keep the Sabbath, it's right under them nose. Yes. Here Romans 6:12-14, Elder Marcel, the same Paul. Somebody say same Paul. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lust. And do not present your what? Your members, your body parts, as instruments of unrighteousness to sin. But present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not have dominion over you. For you are not under law, but under what? Grace. But some people say, see, Pastor, with the under grace, when the under law, when somebody's under the law, it means that they have broken the law. Yes. They have run into what? Trouble with the law. When I was rushing down one year with Sister Naomi's car, Pastor Heath, because I had some work to do with, no, I think my insurance was due and I was broke. Your pastors can get broke too. And I was broke. And so I had to wait until month end to insure the car. So I left it at my house in Chilani, parked up in the garage. And while heading down to Ocherius to pick up a friend to go visit somebody in Kingston, I was in Salem. And just as I came to Salem at the stoplight, I saw a radio car, police car, with a few other vehicles in front of me with the radio car at the head. When we got to the first set, the first broken white lines, the vehicles before me overtook the radio car right at the stoplight to turn to go up to the church heading towards Sentence Bay. But by the time the last man overtook, the broken white lines ended. And because it's police, me have to drive nice. So I said, okay, let me line up myself and wait until the next broken lines down Lawlands. When I got to Lawlands, I put on my right indicator, also gave a physical signal, come on somebody, come on, turn left, turn right, and when I did that, I pushed out, and here is the police car, and just as I lined up with the police car, I saw this man shot from around the corner, down at where they're building the new Paradisiac scheme now, right at Chester Gate, where the cement company is. But because of a tall tree in the corner, I did a scene before starting the overtake, and the man flashed me, and I flashed him back, and he got the message. Because by this time, the vehicles behind me were already closing in. And so if I were to renege on my intention to overtake, I might have caused an accident. So when I flashed the man and he flashed me back to show that I got his attention, he began to open up. So the road was still, the road was wide enough, although he had to go over the white line, which is on the sidewalk. But nobody was walking, and there was no bad road. It's nice highway quality, but the white line means you must stay in line. And by this time, watch what I'm going on. Police car, Pastor JJ, man passed me and honked me for say, you're good, man, we're good. I understood the assignment. Huh? Beep, 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 beep. But back now, I said, Lord, trouble did it. So when I was through, put on my left indicator, came back in front of police car, because they're just a walls, you know. You can overtake a police car given that you do it legally. And I said, no, something feels funny. I know such trouble, did it. And just as I was ready now to press on it, I hear, wah! And the police flashed the light off of me, Elder Kingsley. And when the man flashed me, I said, yes, no. Yes, punished on. And when I pulled over, The man stopped the car behind me and squatted, jumped out of the front with him big M16 and Sarge walked up to the rear window right behind the passenger seat and knocked on it, and I wound it down and I looked back. He said, "Good morning, sir. The name is Sergeant Brown, and I'm going to give you a ticket for reckless driving. You saw the man coming with his flashes on. It could be an emergency." I just tilted over to the car. Man, he was in a hot temper, and I said to him gently, I said, "Good morning, Sarge. It was an indiscretion. I didn't notice the man because of the tall tree until I was parallel to your vehicle." I said, "I'm going to give you a ticket." I said, "Officer, it was an indiscretion." And he was pressing the matter. He said, "By the time I saw him, I flashed him to ensure I got his attention. Notice he flashed me back and began to open up from about 150 meters to show that he understood the assignment. When I saw the vehicles behind me closing into the spot, I had to continue to overtake and take a defensive driving decision because the people had already taken up my spot and were to slam my brake in the middle of the road. It could cause an accident, and you see him want to charge me. It was an indiscretion." And he said, "But listen, man, you're giving me an excuse." That's with all due respect, officer. Of all the times in the world that I would attempt to overtake a vehicle illegally, it would certainly not be while overtaking the police. And he calmed down for a moment as in to say, "It's reasonable." But because in this so vexed already, he said, "Documents, please." I said, "Boy, this one rough." And I took out the documents and he looked at them. And when I thought the man was going to give me an admonition and send me off, the man walked off to head to the vehicle behind him. So I came out of the car. Gently, you know, one thing got things say attack me, attack. And when I came out of the car and I stood there, the man paused. And Sarge looked at the document and he looked at my license and he looked at me. And he said, "Jermaine Johnson." And I said, "Yes, officer." And the man said, "Pastor Jermaine Johnson." Mr. Which, and the man said, "Of the Spring Garden District of Seventh-day Adventist Churches in South Shalonia and Chaplain of the St. Anne Police Division at headquarters." He said, "My pastor." And I said, "Which makes it even more indiscretionate." I don't know Brother Brown, but when he said, "My pastor," I got the message that he's an Adventist. And he said, "Pastor, you have to be careful on the road, because if you're careless, you could endanger the lives of others, including your own." And I said, "That is true, officer. And I'm sorry about the indiscretion. I try my very best to be more careful going forward." And he gave me the documents and said, "Have a nice day, Pastor." And I said, "Thank you. And by the way, I appreciate the grace." Now imagine, I drive like a saint for the rest of the day, and I still do. Imagine if Sergeant Brown catch me a speed or bad drive that afternoon. I want me to tell Sergeant Brown, say, "Sergeant Brown, because you gave me grace this morning, I'm no longer under law. You have to let me go. Look here, walk out, say, Pastor JJ." Are you listening to the preacher, brethren? So though we are under grace, not under law, can I tell you what grace does? Go to Titus 2:11 through 14. You ready? "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to whom? All men, teaching us." By the way, so grace teach?
Teach us.
If grace teaches, grace has to use a curriculum. Are you in the preacher tonight? If grace is a teacher, grace has a curriculum. Somebody say, teach it. "Teaching us that denying ungodliness," how will you know what is ungodliness without the commandments, "and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, godly in this present age, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself to for us, that he might redeem us from every what? Lawless deed." So grace teaches that you must avoid lawlessness. And sin is lawlessness. "And purify for himself his own special people, zealous for what? Good works." So even when you're under grace, God expects good works. Don't let anybody fool you. It's about understanding the Bible in context. Somebody say amen. That's why the same Paul says in Romans 6:15 through 16, "What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law but under grace? Certainly not," he says. "Do you not know that whom to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one slaves whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or obedience leading to righteousness?" That is why 1 John, when did 1 John get written? After the ascension of Jesus. 1 John 3, 4 and 2, 6. "Whoever commits sin also commits" what, everybody? "Lawlessness." So if there's a murderer, lawlessness. If there's a thief, lawlessness. What if there's a Sabbath breaker? Lawlessness. This is why many don't want to acknowledge it. Do it there right under them nose. Because if they are to accept this truth, a lot of churches would have to change them logo. A lot of churches would have to get new signs. A lot of churches would have to change their day of worship. Are you following me, brothers and sisters? If they are supposed to accept this truth, Elder Luke, a lot of businesses are going to lock down. Because Saturday is going to make the place ghost town. But notice what Rome has done. Rome turned Sunday in a ghost town. And met the Lord's Day in a business day. And do we see the truth in the Bible? Right under our nose. Some of us are still despising God's Sabbath. I'm glad you came up in this. Nobody can talk to me. Now what are you going to say? That my pastor and I are going to be lost? God loves us. And we don't believe like that. Adventists are judgmental. And a mere talk, a pure scriptures mere talk, person. Good scriptures. Bam, bam, bam. Scripture. After scripture. Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness. And sin is what? Lawlessness. And you know that Jesus was manifested to take away our sins. And in him there is no sin. Whoever abides in him does not sin. And whoever sins has neither seen nor known him. Here 1 John 3:24. Now he who keeps his commandments abides in him and he in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us. Somebody say, you see, Pastor, and the Holy Ghost Jesus give way. Hear what Holy Ghost give you. John 16:13. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into what? All truth. In other words, you never know some truths before. But when you get the Holy Ghost, every truth are going to come clear. Come on, somebody. So if you have the Holy Ghost, how am I going to lead you to Sabbath yet? Because you don't want to acknowledge it, though it is under your nose. What is truth? If the Spirit of God will lead you into truth, it is necessary to find out what truth is, Sister Sasha. Listen to Psalm 119, 142. Are you ready? Thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and your law is the truth. Come on, somebody. Somebody say right there, sir. So Romans 3:27-31 says, do we then may void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law. When you establish something, you're not broke it down, you build it up. That's why we keep the Sabbath holy. That's why we give up working on Saturdays. That's why from sunset Friday to sunset Saturday we lock down. Not because we couldn't find work to do, but God's commandments that were placed inside of the Ark of the Covenant tells us that we must keep it holy. Come on, somebody. So the Bible says, when Paul talks about the unwriting of ordinances and food and drink, all these things have nothing to do with the Ten Commandments. So even the feast days, let nobody judge you by a special day. These feast days refer to feasts that were pointing to Jesus. The Sabbath is not a part of that. But they were known as Sabbaths. Are we together? Four of the feasts, the seven feasts, occurred in the spring of the year. They are Passover, unleavened bread, first fruit, and Pentecost. And the three final feasts took place in the fall of the year. Feast of Trumpets, the Day of Atonement, carry on, and the Feast of Tabernacles. And the Bible referred to these days in Leviticus 23, that you should bring a burnt offering, and a grain offering, and a sacrifice, and a drink offering. Move on, move on. Come on, click along, click along, click again. Click again. There you go. So when he said let nobody judge you by food or drink, he was referring to those offerings that were offered during those feast days called Sabbaths or general Sabbath days, but not the Ten Commandments seventh day Sabbath. Are we together? That is what Paul was saying. Now that Jesus fulfilled those, now let nobody tell you, so you must carry grain again. How you carry grain and drink, but you're not carrying a goat and cow? Those were the things Paul was addressing. Are we together, brethren? So watch me now. What about the covenant? Listen to what the Ark of the Covenant has led to. In Luke 22, verse 20, Luke, the Bible tells us there, likewise Jesus took the cup after the supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. What was the ark called? The ark of the covenant. Why? Because God placed the Ten Commandments, which is the covenant, inside. Come on, church of God. So here the new covenant that Jesus has created. Are you ready? When he drank the cup at the Last Supper, he said, this is the cup of the what? The new covenant. What are the requirements, Sister Samantha, of the new covenant? Go to Hebrews 8 and verse 10. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws where? In their mind, and write them on their what? Hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. So God not nail the laws to the cross, he nailed them to your heart. If you have Jesus in your heart, you will keep his commandments, including the 7-day Sabbath. And if you are a Christian, you follow Christ. Somebody say, follow Christ. When did Christ go to church? Well, some people call Sunday the Lord's Day. Listen to what Jesus calls the Lord's Day. Mark 2, 27, 28. And he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man. By the way, go on there. If something is not for you, Pastor Heath, what is it? Against you. What did Jesus blot out? The handwriting of what? Ordinances that were what? Against you. Was the Ten Commandments stated anywhere in the Old Testament as being against us? No. Hear what Jesus says of the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made what? For man and not man for the Sabbath. So God, no, that's your way, because it is not against your Lord of mercy. Come on, somebody. Work with the preacher now. When you watch a movie 1.5 hour, you keep up. When you watch a 2-hour movie, them, you're up like 7. You're going to listen to sermon and so done. Therefore, the Son of Man is the what? Lord of the Sabbath. Which day did Jesus claim to be his day? The Lord's day. The 7-day Sabbath. Brethren, if it is clear, say thank you, Jesus. It can't get no plainer than that, Sister John. Can't get any plainer than that, Sister Messam. That's why Luke 4 verse 16 says, and he, Jesus, came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was. When something is a custom, it means, say, you practice it. Am I talking the truth? He went into the synagogue in Daniel's on the what? The Sabbath day. And stood up to read. And I just visit church. He was an active member of the church. So if you are a Christian, you must go to church on the day that Jesus went. Brethren, it cannot be that these Bible texts are under our nose. I will still ignore the truth. Hello, somebody. You can read a text like this. Here we preach it again and again. And still got church on Sunday. I said, this is the Lord's day. I have the indecency. I said, this is the day. And this is the day that the Lord lied. Jesus went to church on the 7-day Sabbath. And every man, woman, boy, or girl who willfully ignores this text, you are ignoring the truth under your nose, and God is going to judge you for it. Amen. Listen to me now. There are 8 texts in the Bible, in the New Testament, that speak of the first day of the week. 8 dege, Brother Mitchell. And not one of them sanctions a change of the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. I want to quickly run through them, then tell you when the disciples and the Gentiles went to church and finished. Listen to them. You ready? One by one. Matthew 28 verse 1. Come on, everybody. Now, after the Sabbath, after the what church? The Sabbath. As the first day of the week, see there, began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the mother of Jesus came to the tomb to see Jesus. Remember that he died on the Friday, they called it Good Friday. And then he rose on the Sunday morning, they called it Easter Sunday. They had gotten the spices and the herbs to what? Embalm his body and anoint him up. But they never got to do it because Sabbath was drawing near. So they went by the tomb now Sunday morning with the sole purpose of gaining access to the tomb to rub down Jesus' body with the spice. So he's not rotten like some dead dog. But in and taking a little time and rotten over time in a decent way, decompose over time. Are we together, brethren? But hear this. When they came to the tomb, you know that he was risen. Question, did that tell you that Jesus, the Sabbath is changed? Question, what do they call that Sunday morning when they went to find Jesus and couldn't find him? The first day of the week, what do they call it nowadays when Easter come mountain? They might call it Resurrection Sunday, Easter Sunday. How them know the Easter Sunday but none was the day we done before that a Sabbath? Come on, somebody, man. A hypocrite. Some of you are good members, but you have been dubbed you are drunken with Babylon's wine. And if there's one person in the church that should know these things, it's the pastor, the bishop, the priest, the apostle, whatever they call themselves. But you are there defending pastor and cursing all pastors like myself who tell you the truth. Brethren, have I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? You're not done yet. The second, eight of them I'm going through. Mark 16, 1 and 2. Now when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought what? Spices, that they might come and anoint him. At the same story, different account. Very early in the morning on the what? First day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. Did you see anything about the Sabbath being changed? No. So question, they are going to celebrate Jesus on the 31st of this month. Yes. Saying that they must sing like they must say resurrection, you know. They must sing about the resurrection. He is risen and he reigns. The Bible said the first day always comes after the Sabbath. And the Bible says the Sabbath is the what? The seventh day. So how them tell us they don't know which day the seventh day? Me see the look for your face. It's shocking, not true. How them said they don't know which day is the seventh day? I'm not finished yet. Next, number three. Mark 16:9. Now when he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven demons. Did you see a change of the Sabbath there? Oh, what? Everybody knows that day that he was risen on is what? That he rose on is the first day of the week. The Bible tells us a weekend, and you will make it a week start. Everything that God does, Satan does the opposite. God said, man must marry woman. Satan said, take one man to man, man to man. Woman to woman. You know you are going here, sir. God said, weekend. Satan said, you're mad? Weak front. And that is why we must break out of the habit, Adventists, of calling Sunday weekend. Because what they are doing now, they are even changing up the calendar to put the first day as Monday, confusing our children. But any day named day, you invite your child to name the days of the week and then tell you anything but what you know, there's a problem in the house. You know the days of the week? Come here. I'm calling a child, I'm teaching you again tonight. This is a little co-evangelist, got baptized the other day. Come here. Clap the preacher. I wanted to teach them for me. The days of the week are
Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday.
Clap the boy. Lord of mercy, make your one book figure one of your friends them. You're bright. Well done. Brothers and sisters, I randomly called that child. How old is he again, Elder Shah? 7 years old. And he never had to guess the order of the days of the week. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Are you going to meet a big, grown, gray-haired priest? Our pastor, tell us, brethren, we don't know what day is the seventh day. What did the prophecy of Daniel 7:25 say? He shall think to change what? Times and law. Here is the commandment with a time sign, signature to it. And this is the one that Satan church are trying to change. And all of Christendom, generally speaking, willfully violates this and still call themselves Christians. And Adventists now have no Holy Ghost. But you are break God's commandment. Every week, put on your nice fancy suit. Drive up in your car, in a church, and jump up and praise the Lord. And God the upper heaven and watch and say, you go on there. Go on there, man. You go on worship. Because guess what? A Dally House business here galang with down there, so and I got mash up with Dally House. Are you hearing me, Crossroads? It gets better. I'm moving on quickly now. Time. Luke chapter 23 and 24 further on. That day was the preparation day. The day he was crucified. See the name of it? The preparation day. Call it Good Friday. The preparation day. And when the child says, what are you preparing for? What will you say? The Sabbath. And the Sabbath junior, come on now. Hey, the Bible clear enough, sister. Look, the Bible show you that when the preparation day was happening, Sabbath was coming. It shows you that when the resurrection day was happening, Sabbath just done. So them know the two slices of bread, but they don't know the meat in the middle. Then celebrate the first slice of bread Friday, then call it Good Friday. Then celebrate the second slice of bread Sunday, resurrection morning. But them not touch the meat and the lettuce and the tomato and God's mayo and all of them cheese there, so in the middle. It is called the Sabbath. And a lot of people, Elder Carter, don't pick out them nice dress for Easter weekend and are going to violate the seventh day Sabbath for go keep on pagan tradition of Easter. And then nyam bun and cheese and cut a tent and belch and go like say, God, I go take away your game. If he never take cane fruits, he not take for you. Are you in the preacher tonight, somebody? The Bible says the women had come to from with him from Galilee, followed after, and they observed the tomb and how it was laid, the preparation day. Then they returned and prepared the spices and fragrant oils, and they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. Then Luke 24 picks it up. Now when on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came with the other women, and they came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared, but they found that the stone rolled away from the tomb because Jesus was risen. Did he say that the Sabbath was changed on that first day? When did the women prepare the spices again, everybody? Friday. Why didn't they go and bomb the body Friday evening? They want Jesus to start stink because it's Sabbath, June 9. Did you hear Jesus cursing? Why you never rub me down Friday? No! Not even God's funeral not get attended on Sabbath.
Take your time, preacher.
But you expect me if you come and feel? Yeah. Not even God never allow this funeral to happen on a Sabbath. That's why Jesus never get up on day two. But you left church and gone a people funeral on Saturday. Adventist children, I know that another first me say to you, so some of you repent, so big up yourself, you're not do that. That's in the past. You don't do it anymore. Somebody say amen. Amen. But still some still hide and seek. And so them come a Sabbath school and then just teeth for a little bit, go show them face and come back. God see you. Even Jesus' funeral was unattended on a Saturday, and you get up gone. Listen to me, Brother Bury. When I was a youngster in the church, I mean, all like that, almost every funeral happened on a Sunday.
Yes.
And I never forget about 20 years ago, I heard the Baptist people saying in my community, oh, say, what are the Adventists, them bright here, Pastor? Them now must go funeral on Sunday. Panfui Sabbath, and then God for them 7 days Sabbath go worship, and then Sunday, which is our Sabbath, them now come a funeral. So you know what they started to do? To conduct the funerals on Saturday. Tell me, say, never see the change. And instead of standing up against it to be a witness to the truth of God's Sabbath, some Adventists take them dead self, Ghana Sabbath funeral. Why me say you're dead? Jesus said, let the dead be buried, they're dead. But you go and preach the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. Take themselves, go and a funeral, Pastor. You know when one person said to me fiercely, Pastor Johnson, what if it's your mother? I said, like, duh, I determine when she get buried. Say, Pastor, he to grieve there. And his father died. The funeral is Sunday, April 21. And him a big boy. Yes. Not the full big boy we study about when you grew up. So nobody can go tell him when to bury daddy. But sometimes the family have stronger Sunday ties and will insist to them now go choose on Thursday or so. Then we have to show you who are boss. Guess what? Play for your part and keep the Sabbath holy. You know, you're the preacher inside here tonight, brethren. Come on, somebody. And for those who again were first born, say you have to come in a church, a funeral and grave, come a casket, come up a front. Jesus moved right after tree in a grave. Yes. And you are come altar. You must have Godfather. Jesus moved from tree to grave. But you have to come altar. Get back here. Next, give me till 9:30. It's not 9:16. I'm gonna cut it short and summarize. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. That's John's account. Did he say that the Sabbath was changed? Go to another account of John 20 verse 19. Then the same day at that evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, peace be with you. Did he change the Sabbath? Go to Acts then, the next book. Now on the first day of the week, Acts 20 verse 7, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul, ready to depart the next day, spoke to them and continued his message until midnight. Some say, you see it? Paul did a priest Sunday. It's Sunday night going into Monday. And not only that, God never say you can't have church no other day. But a one day is the Sabbath of the Lord. Yeah. And if you use another day to substitute it, you are defying the commandment of God. Yeah. There were many lamps in the upper room. Sabbath is from sunset to sunset. So no Sabbath could go on in the night there. Unless you say the first day or the second day of the week, which is Monday of the Sabbath. Yeah. And you know say Sunday of the first day. Because you go acknowledge it, mountain. Last one, 1 Corinthians chapter 16, 1 to 2. Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given orders to the churches of Galatia, so you must also do. On the first day of the week, let each one of you lay something aside, storing up as he may prosper, that there may be no collections when I come. Why was Paul sending the people to gather the foodstuff and supply for aid for those who were suffering because they were thrown out for accepting the truth, the Christians in Jerusalem? Why did Paul send them out on the first day to go get the yam and cocoa for argument's sake and the different stuff that they wanted to send? Because he never acknowledged the first day as Sabbath. Because Paul knows the Sabbath, you know, if you do not work, come on, somebody.
Yes. Yes, sir.
God tell us that if you go during the manna season, go look the food on the Saturday, you shall not find it on the seventh day. That's why we're not going to shop Adventist on Saturday. Yes. That's why we don't skip Bible class and go on a progressive. That's why we don't left church at AY time and go on a public America. I remember my wife said the one named Canada name. So because Paul never had it in mind, Elder Kingsley, that Sunday is the Sabbath. Paul said, at that time, they must go put the collection together. Get the goat where you want to send at Jerusalem. Get the banana. Get the yam, whatever you get. And pack it up because you can't do work for the first day. The Bible is clear, brothers and sisters. May I say, some of foreign left church Sabbath afternoon and go a fellowship lunch at restaurant Palm Mall. God is watching you. So some say, well, Pastor, all right, we know that God never changed it, but we have changed it to celebrate the resurrection. Really? Number one, communion is the memorial of Christ's death. 1 Corinthians 11, 26. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Yes. Baptism is the memorial of Christ's resurrection. For as what? Buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. That's why I want to sprinkle you like the fast system. You have to go under the water because you can't bury man and left out in two and we stink. You have to have enough water for everything so much. Come on, somebody. Go all the way under. And then when you come up, it's like a spiritual death. And you come up to newness of life. That's why some of us are cross. We don't go and eat the water. We don't get the baptism. So you're still living your spiritual death. Sabbath coming is baptism again. You can have a new life in Jesus Christ. Sign up for your baptism. Somebody say amen. So watch the ending now. This message could have been preaching too, but may I take it on now? If Christ had changed the Sabbath, who would have been the first set of people to know? The disciples. But the question is, which day did they attend church? Brother Campbell, give me some water there, sir. Which day did they attend church? Put it on the screen. Acts 13, understand, I won't read you all of them. You're going to write them down and read them in your timing. Thank you. Acts 13, 14 through 15, verse 27, and verse 42 to 44. When they had departed from Perga, they came to Antioch in Pisidia and went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and sat down. The apostles went to church on Saturday, the Sabbath day, in the early church. And after the reading of the law, hold on there. What did I read? The reading of the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent to them saying, men and brethren, if you have any words of exhortation for the people, say on. For those who dwell in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not know him, Paul, nor even the voices of him, Jesus, nor even the voices of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath. A Sabbath, them did not go to church, not the Christian church. So if you are Pentecostal, a Saturday, if you go to church. Have been fulfilled in condemning him. But you know, you're not yet. Johnson, they are Jews. They were Jews. We are Gentiles. Verse 42. So when the Jews went out of the synagogue, the Gentiles begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. When the Gentiles go to church. Sabbath. Come on, somebody. Pastor, not touch this text here. That will never happen. You will never live to see him preach it. And the Bible says, when the congregation was broken up, they persuaded the men. Listen up, verse 44. Read this, everybody. On the next Sabbath, almost the whole city came together to hear the word of God. Who asked him to come back? Gentiles. So guess who did they in a church on Sabbath day? Jews and Gentiles. So who said Jews got church Saturday and Gentiles got Sunday? Lie.
None.
Ask your pastor to explain that. Acts 16:13. And on the Sabbath day, we went out of the city to a riverside where prayer was customarily made. That means that every Sabbath then go there. Acts 17:1-4. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. Then Paul, as his what? Custom was, just like Jesus. The same Paul that they used to say that the laws are nailed to the cross because they misunderstood what the man meant. Then Paul, as his custom was, went into them and for three Sabbaths, just like come this Sabbath, three Sabbaths, me out here preach. Three Sabbaths, reason with them from the scriptures. But me have a question now. Who you did I talk to, Paul? Ask me now. Who were you talking to, Paul? Hear it. Explaining and demonstrating that the Christ had to suffer and rise again from the dead, saying, this Jesus whom I preach to you is the Christ. And some of them were persuaded. Who then at the church? Brother Thomas. And a great multitude of what? Devout Greeks. Give me another name for the Greeks. Gentiles. Yes, sister, son. And not a few of the leading women joined Paul and Silas. Acts 18 verse 4. He reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded both what? Jews and Gentiles. Who said Gentiles got church Sunday? The early Gentiles went to church on the seventh day of the week. Plain like daylight. Both Jews and Gentiles kept the Sabbath after Jesus went back to heaven. So when this Sunday keeping coming, it was Emperor Constantine. Brothers and sisters, it was later on, early 4th century, that the Christian church, as I showed the other night, struck a compromise and they decided to substitute the Lord's true Sabbath with Sunday keeping, with keeping with the pagan tradition of worshiping the sun. And they made the law, God studied, AD 321, to change God's Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. What an audacity. And when you study even the Catholic historians, they will tell you, say we know, say we do it. Because God said, well, we bind down here, bind up there. How we loose down here, loose up there. As a matter of fact, they have trampled on the laws of God. Move to the next two slides. They have trampled on the laws of God. The next one. Go again. The Catholic Church was the one to do it. The early church had everybody come on, worshiping on the seventh day of the week, sister long, as the Sabbath of the Lord, both Jews and Gentiles. And it wasn't until this time that Sunday became a thing in the Christian church. Not even Adventists never come about them time this. And now we change it. Pentecostal never did it. Jehovah Witness never did it. Latter-day Saints never did it. Baptists never did it. None of them never did it. This is where it started, the Catholic Church. And they twisted up the command. commandments of God. And when you are becoming a Catholic convert, you have to go through studies. And the book is called the Converse Catechism of the Catholic Doctrine. And they ask, you know what they do? They put the Sabbath as a third commandment. But you know, no matter where they, it's the fact that whether or not you keep it. And they ask, what is the third commandment? In that book you have to study. The third commandment is, remember that thou keep holy the Sabbath day. Here the next question in the book. Which is the Sabbath day? Here the answer. Saturday is the Sabbath day. Here the next question. Go and get a copy online. Why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? We observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. So when you go to church on a Sunday and talk about say, I want God the way we serve. And I've got to tell you if you go to church Sunday. But some of you never knew. So what God do? Wink. But no, we command all men to repent. Why did they do that, Sister Carter? The church substituted Sunday for Saturday because Christ rose from the dead on a Sunday. And the Holy Ghost descended upon the apostles on a Sunday. You see the audacity of men, brethren? This is the church that Daniel 7:25 prophesied about. Shall think to change what? Time. God said that the time should be the seventh day of the week. They change it to when? The first day of the week. And law, God's fourth commandment law. No, make nobody fool you, brethren. Even their own historians. Read about them. Bernard Cardinal Griffin. They said that it is interesting, I'm summarizing in the interest of time, that even those who claim say they run left Catholic Church and are Protestants still carry the Sunday in their pocket. They are not protesting. They are professing Catholicism. Because whether or not you call it by this name or that name, if it violates the commands of God, you are on the same ship. That's why Revelation 18, 1 to 5 says what? Babylon is fallen, pagan Rome. Babylon is fallen, papal Rome. And all of those hateful birds and creatures represent those who are preaching and teaching the lies. And Joel Osteen would say, just find a good Bible believing church and attend because God loves you, God says, my church, keep the commandments of God and of the testimony of Jesus. So what is the appeal? Come out of her, my people. This is a loving call. As rebuking as the message might sound, the message is a message of love. Though you might be worshiping in the false system, God knows that some of you are not doing it because you are a rebel. He knows that you are doing it thinking you were doing the right thing. So that's why I never say you are wicked. He said, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins. Unless you receive her plagues, for her sins have reached up to heaven. And God has remembered her iniquities. But pastor, like come then at the church 20 years, God must can't give me a blind man. Matthew 15:9, and in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Who made Sunday? Man. Who made Sabbath? The seventh day. God. Tonight you can choose God or you can choose man-made tradition. Anybody who violates the law, God is going to charge him. In 1 Samuel 15, God told Saul to kill everything. Saul speared the best of the sheep. And what did Samuel say to him? To obey is better than sacrifice and to hearken than the fat of rams. That's why the three angels' message of Revelation 14 caused people to come out of the false worship system. Importantly, in Eden, God reserved one tree for himself. That's the one Satan told them to eat from. In Eden, God reserved one day for himself. That's the day Satan told people to violate. That is why last year, I did an interview with a former pastor who has become Seventh-day Adventist out of that system. And the interview is still on our YouTube channel for those of you who want to see it. Go and look for the interview, and that is what it looks like. Tonight, as I close, all the popes have been preaching the lies. And all the churches that keep Sunday have been preaching the lies and keeping the lies. But the Bible says, God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And what did I present to you tonight? The truth. Moses' laws were blotted out. They were written in a book. and placed where? Beside the ark. But God's laws were written on stones with God's fingers. And placed where? Inside of the ark. And now in the new covenant, where has God written them? Inside of our hearts. Are we Jews? The Bible says we are no longer Jew according to the circumcision of the flesh, but the circumcision of the what? Heart. God wants to cut your heart and place his laws there. Because if it's not in you, it cannot come out. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against thee. Tonight, I start with a general call. If you will pledge your allegiance to the God of the Sabbath by keeping all of his commandments, including the seventh-day Sabbath, come to the altar, whoever you are. It's a general call. Sing that song, Sister Molly. If you will, online, I want you to type 7 for the seventh-day Bible Sabbath in the chat. 7. All 900 are not devices. Come on. Praise the Lord. Sing that song. If you tonight will stand with God and the Sabbath
Holy
that he has created,
day,
come to the altar.
Jehovah's rest of creation, week the best. Last of all the chosen seven, blessed of God to men.
Pastor Heath, prepare to do the closing prayer for me. Sing that
welcome,
song. This song, listen to the words.
First the sixth, as we was done,
then the Sabbath.
Then the Sabbath was
if you will
begun,
stand with God and the Sabbath truth, come to the altar.
Bless the seventh day, the sinner, still we obey. Welcome,
it's on the screen, go ahead and sing it. Before you go to the next verse, if you are already surrendered to God, keeping the Sabbath holy and all his commandments, praise the Lord. I affirm you tonight and admonish you to keep on keeping his commandments by his grace. But if you are here tonight and you have not yet surrendered to God, you have not been obeying his Sabbath, but tonight you want to stand on the Lord's side, I want you to come in the middle. Come right in the front. Yeah, man, come right in the front. Step out. All those who are here tonight who are not devout Sabbath keepers, but you have seen the clear truth tonight, and you want to say, God, I may not have known before now, but the truth has come right under my nose, and I'm not going to ignore it. Come right in the middle. We want to pray with you. Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. Don't be shy. You have not yet surrendered your life to Jesus, and you want to stand on the side of righteousness. We want to pray for you tonight. Come right in the middle. Come right in the middle. If you are online, go ahead and click decision card, or scan the QR code on the decision card on the screen and fill it out. Who's going to step out? Come on now. All those who want to stand on the side of righteousness with Jesus Christ tonight, come to the front if you have not yet given your hearts to him. Amen. We see those at the side. Is there another? Don't be ashamed, young men. Those who are on the outside, don't stay away from God unless you want him to stay away from you. Step boldly to the altar. We want to pray for you. Come. Come. Encourage somebody along the way. Sing that song.
Thousands have this plan resumed.
Come.
Resting now upon the first.
Search the book and you shall know.
There's no scripture.
There's no scripture.
Let's sing it, everybody.
So
welcome. Come on now.
Welcome.
Welcome.
Welcome,
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 welcome, come to the
welcome
altar.
Welcome,
amen.
Come, his presence.
Come. that song tonight.
All who speaks the truth,
all who speak the truth.
This was man who changed the day.
Is there another?
Words, no change appear.
Is there another? Come on, let's sing that song. Welcome, welcome. Sister C and those watching, those hearing my voice, tonight's message is not the most popular, but it is the truth. Tonight's message is one that often causes great offense, but it is the truth. Tonight's message will cause some to scoff at Pastor JG and the Seventh-day Adventist Church, but it is the truth. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. In the quietness of this moment, let me say this to you. Perhaps before now, you were ignorant. But right now, it under your nose. It under your nose. And if it is under your nose, it means that it is right in front of your eyes. You will not be able, as of this message, having heard it, to worship on a Sunday in good conscience and believe that you can commend yourself to God. With all due love, God is calling you, if you are a true Christian, to give up the false doctrine and to keep the Sabbath holy. You're going to have a fallout with Bishop and some members, but it better man dash you out and God take you in than God dash you out and man take you in. You know where to find the Seventh-day Adventist Church. You know where to find me. You are watching from overseas or some other place. You know that God has called you to the truth. Several baptized through our programs last year from the Sunday church and sent us videos and messages from overseas. Wherever you are, whoever you are, the truth has come to you tonight. And just as you are tempted to listen to that old rascal called the devil, that one day not going to change nothing, it's one disobedient act brought sin. God requires obedience of his children. Monday night I told you about the mark of the beast. This same Sunday keeping is what's going to constitute it. God is calling all of his children now to be obedient to him. But as Pastor gets ready to pray, somebody might be saying, Pastor, this sounds like it is a church thing. Those who are keeping Fast Day versus those who are keeping Saturday. I don't keep any of the days, so I'm good to go. God calls everyone to keep his commandments. So even you are being called, though you may not be going to church now. Is there one more pastor he comes to pray? The message has gone forth. God has spoken. What will your answer be? I'll wait for 30 seconds for somebody else to come to the altar. We see those at the side being signed up. After the 30 seconds, he's going to pray. And you will be the judge of what you heard tonight. Under your nose. Jesus says in John 3, 18 going down, this is the condemnation, not because people were ignorant, but because light has come into the world. But men prefer what? They love darkness rather than light. What is he talking about? Isaiah 8:20, to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, there's what? No light in them. They prefer to be in darkness and to keep Sunday or some other day and ignore the plain Sabbath of the Lord, though it's right under their noses. I pray tonight that all of us will keep God's commandments by his grace, to include his holy seventh-day Sabbath. Pastor Heath.
Let us pray. Praise God. Heavenly Father, the stillness of this moment, at the close of another evening, where you have used your manservant to
proclaim the word of truth and soberness. Oh God, we thank you. We thank you tonight for the preacher. But we thank you more, oh God, for the word. Yes. We believe, Heavenly Father, it could not be presented clearer. For indeed, oh Lord, you have spoken and your words have gone forth across the length and breadth of this community. I know, Lord, that some standing by the wayside, some sitting on their veranda, and even in their bedrooms have heard the word tonight. And I know, Lord, that your spirit can find them wherever they are. I know, Lord, that the Holy Ghost is speaking to their hearts. This is the way. Walk ye in it. But Heavenly Father, we know the powers of darkness. We know the powers that be are against what is happening here tonight. But God, they that are with us are more than they that are against us. And I'm glad, Lord, the preacher did not come to preach against church. But Lord, he has spoken the plain, thus saith the Lord. And Lord, I pray tonight that those who heard him, those who are listening even now, will come to the reality, oh God, that there's a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof is death. Lord, broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be that find it. But we're happy, God, that straight and narrow is the way. But indeed, Lord, a few will find it. And tonight, God, you say many are called, but few have chosen. We thank you tonight for those who have decided in their hearts to follow Jesus. We're happy tonight, God, for those who have decided in their hearts and are saying, goodbye world, I stay no longer with you. God, this coming Sabbath, when the water is troubled, I hear somebody says, what does hinder me from being baptized? Holy Ghost, tonight, Lord, we pray that shackles will be broken, lives will be transformed, and when the water is troubled this Sabbath, souls will be born for your kingdom.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, we thank you that the message didn't only speak to those who are without, but those who are within. Help us, Heavenly Father, that while we listen, that we will make our calling and election sure. Help us, Lord, to walk in obedience to your law. As we make our way home now, we ask that you'll give us journeying mercy. Cover us, we pray, Heavenly Father. May your Holy Spirit keep the word that we have heard, so that when you return to claim your own from this earth, we will hear from your lips, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thank you for tonight's experience. Save somebody, we pray. In Jesus' name, let God's people say, amen. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, preacher man. Brothers and sisters, we bless the name of Jesus. Even as we go tonight and prepare for tomorrow night's message, how to tie your man or woman, I just want you to know that on Friday evening, the rest evening at 7 o'clock for half an hour, we will stream that interview with the pastor who became a Seventh-day Adventist last year, because he has been grappling with this message for a long time. DDC is online. Like the link. Share it. Subscribe if you are new. Go back and say something about the video in the comments afterwards, and help somebody who needs to hear this unpopular truth to come to the knowledge of the word of God, that they may obey him in every way. God bless you, and have a good night as our host come to take us out.
What a word, Sister Suka. What a word, what a message. Another night of deliverance. Surely our God is good.
Yes, I saw someone on YouTube says, Karna Mash. We bless God for using his manservant in such a way tonight to deliver his message. We were truly blessed and understanding was clear.
Definitely clear. Not only was understanding clear, right? But according to one of our DDCs, this is Karen Lynch Frater, who was very, very active in the chat. And I see in bracket Dr. KFL. She said, tonight, spiritual hard food was served. No milk was served tonight. And that is definitely true, right? I really and truly believe that even though it was hard food, it was clear to the point.
Yes.
Right. So what do you have to tell our online friends and those who
continue
are leaving?
To our online friends, continue to be the digital disciples that you are. Share the link, spread the word, and come and worship with us. Tonight we had our DDCs for Christ, very active, Sister Fiona, on Facebook and also on YouTube. Just to name a few over on Facebook where there was more than 20 devices.
Excellent.
I know the chat was active. Sandra Lovindear, Sharnette Smith, Carlene Bennett McLaren, and Nelia Boo Watson Williams, just to name a few.
Okay, and on YouTube we had over 900, right?
Yes.
Over 900 and odd persons were on. And Trisha Campbell, very active. Cheryl Russell, News Flash, you know, is there every night. Sandra Morant, Upliftment, Block Factory, Veronica Berry, Cordell Van Horn. And I would have said before, Karen Lynch Frater,
yes.
Right? Those were some of our active DDCs on YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Sister Fiona, tonight we'll be leaving with blessings.
Yeah.
We were truly blessed. On behalf of our series team, we wish you all a good night. Be safe and remember to bring a friend and let us worship together when you will hear how to tie your man or woman. God bless you. Good night.
Have a good night, everyone. Blessings.